about as being P3, because there are key differences, there's certainly some differences in how you deal with them, how you deal with government. In the world we live in, it's all about risk transfer, right? That is the key thing. This is what we sell to governments, this is why we tell them that they should work with the private sector. It's really about taking risk out of their requirements and putting them into the private sector's hands, generally so they can manage them better. There's also all these additional sort of add-on benefits, particularly now where, many government entities haven't done infrastructure for decades, some of them in centuries, if you could argue, time is really important. Do they have the people in place? Do they have the expertise in place? Do they know how to do these particular things? The other interesting thing is, it's interesting for me to hear people talk about real things. The other thing is, governments generally don't make money. Most of these projects don't make money. Most of the things that the government does don't make money. And yet at the same time, they still need the private sector's help to do the things the government is supposed to do. So again, the way we would look at it is that the places where government can help corporations to help businesses run is a relatively small part of their total world. And the things that government do that actually make money is also very small. So what do you do with all those other things? Those are going to benefit from these methodologies, these concepts as well. So when you kind of go through it, this is how we start by looking at it. Right? And those of you in engineering are probably very, very familiar with this, right? The old way of doing it, the standard way of doing it, is design, bid, build, right? That's how you start one of these projects. You find a designer, they design it. You get the design, you take it to a contractor, you get them to build it, and then once they've built it, they hand it over and say, okay, I'm done with it now, right? And what's happened over the years, what we found sort of in the Canadian context, but even that was based on some experience that happened in Europe, is that's a terrible way of doing things. Right? If you have a great government, you have a great contractor, you have a great designer, you can often make that work, but those things generally don't match up. And in fact, even if you have all three of those great things, coordinating each one of those things is a very difficult task. The architect fights with the government, the architect fights with the designer fights with the contractor. It generally ends up in a mess. So what's happened over the years is people have not moved on is a design build. Right? Design build is sort of the next stage where people start working together. But when we start talking about P3s, about concession P3s, about project finance, it's those last two that we're talking about. So that's the world that I'm going to shape around, the one that I want to talk about. And again, I always have to start these charts because people say, oh, well, P3s, that's this. Well, P3s means something different to everyone, and so that's really the focus on sort of what we're looking at. And the last one being sort of the primary one. When I talk about a P3, I talk about a concession. We talk about a public-private partnership. It's a design, build, finance, operate, maintain structure. It's a particular construction project around a particular thing. And it's about drawing sort of a sphere of influence around that and dealing with the risks in those. Design, build, finance is kind of just before that, where you have all those things, but there's not operating phase. And again, one of the things that's so attractive to governments is this operate phase, where instead of being handed a project and saying, yeah, here's a project, we're done it, isn't it great, we're on budget, everything's on time, 3 years later, you get black molds in the ventilation system. You go back to the contractor, he goes, ah, it's not my problem. I built it to your specs, right? And so this is really an attempt to get to the last piece of it. And the reason why you can do this is because of the financing. If there was no financing for this project, the first three, I'm not involved with. You don't need me. What I do is create the structures and work with the lenders, to work with the advisors, work with the technical advisors to put together these projects. And so you have all those three pieces to make it work. The other way, and we kind of touched on this a little bit, these projects can be generally split into kind of two very different categories. And then each of those categories go into greenfield, brownfield. So revenue risk, those are the projects that actually make money, right? And the reason why you do them, in many cases, are because they do make money. They're self-financing. And so those are the projects that you're most likely to see in the transportation industry. Those are one of the few things that the government does where there's actually cash involved, where there's money involved, where there's profit involved. And you can see, that they range from airports to express lanes to anything that you can put a toll on, bridges and roads and the like. The vast majority of other things that require capital expenditures that government do generally fall into this availability payment category. They're not self-funding. They're courthouses, they're schools, they're university facilities. There are tunnels and other government things that could make money. And in fact, I'll show you an example. We've got a couple cases where the government's just decided, okay, I could make money on this asset, but I'm not going to. Either for political reasons, or they do toll it, but ultimately the tolls go to the government pockets and not into the investor's pocket. And there's a bunch of reasons why that makes sense. And so that's greenfield. So those are brand new things, haven't been done before, there's risk within them. Brownfield is things that exist. And if you like, greenfield is a lot about spending money. And that's the other interesting thing about P3s, certainly the ones that we've done in the past, is it's a lot about spending money for the first column. The second column is all about getting money. So, and that's where we see a lot of the conflict between the two. We have a lot of Chicago and Chicago area deals there. And one of the reasons for that is those P3s aren't about building things. Those P3s are about creating money for the government to use for something else, right? They're asset sales. The other interesting thing, if you look at all those, each one of those, except for parking, which, as you know, didn't go particularly successful in Chicago. But again, the purpose was not to create a good parking system. The purpose was to create money, right? And the money was needed to allocate to fill other parts of the government's budget. Each one of those assets has been resold, right? And in some cases, you could argue that actually the government made a good trade, for example, the Indiana Toll Road and the Chicago Skyway, where the government actually got paid more than ultimately the equity did, because in the trade, they ended up coming back, getting less money than they started with. So you sort of talk about efficiencies. Well, that's another one of those efficiencies. If you're doing the project right, you actually can get paid more as a government for what it's worth in the fullness of time than what it was, what it actually, what the entity paid for.